الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. And do come forward because we have rain and we don't want people to stand at the back. Please come forward, please come forward. Quickly, please, quickly, quickly. Fill the subs. Thank you. The role of a masjid in Islam is important to know. What is the purpose of a masjid? Unlike the Middle East, where masjids are strictly places for worship only. But you find in a place like South Africa, the masjid plays a huge role and a multifaceted, multidisciplinary, different types of roles a masjid plays. It has welfare organizations, has community centers, and even the sites are visited by local politicians. Not that I agree with politicians of this country to come to masajids and disgrace it. But we have to go back in history and see what was the role of Masjid al-Nabawi when it was established. It was a haven for a believer. It was a meeting place for Muslims, and it is the first school from which we as Muslims graduate. This must be the purpose of a masjid. It provides relief and it provides respite to the needy and the distressed. Not so long ago, this masjid was involved with the Somalian Islamophobia, and they came to the masjid. We have our goods that we're selling in the shops. Imam, please, can we put it in the masjid? At least we will stay elsewhere, but take our goods. We opened up our doors of the facilities that we had, and we stored it for them. This is what the masjid is all about. The masjid is not a place only for salah. These masjids should be a springboard to launch the message of Islam and the implementation of Islam. That is why we find in the Quran, Allah strongly advises us to build masajid. As it mentioned in Surah Tawbah, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ما كان للمشركين أن يعمروا مساجد الله شاهدين على أنفسهم بالكفر. It is not for the mushrikun or the disbelievers to maintain the mosques of Allah while they witness against their own disbelief. أُولَٰئِكَ حَبِطَتْ أَعْمَالُهُمْ وَفِي النَّارِ هُمْ خَالِدُونَ. The works, the amal of such, they are in vain, and in fire shall they abide. And the very next verse, Allah is giving you the qualifications and the characteristics what a mutawalli should be, what a member who runs the masajids should be. Here Allah says, إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَى الزَّكَاةَ وَلَمْ يَخْشَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Here we have been given the condition of a mutawalli. Don't take it lightly, my dear brothers, those who are mutawallis of masjid. Allah says, the masjid, the mosques, or the masjid of Allah shall be maintained only by those who believe in Allah and the last day, and perform salah, and give zakah, and fear none but Allah. فَعَسَىٰ أُولَٰئِكَ أَن يَكُونُوا مِنَ الْمُهْتَدِينَ. And perhaps it is they who are expected to be on the true guidance. Allah has spoken. Ya Allah. So we find, we go back in the history of Islam. The first thing that our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he entered in Medina, was to build a masjid. a very modest and very basic. Its pillars were palm trees. SubhanAllah, if I just look outside, my dear brothers, it's a reflection of Madinatul Munawwara. Look at this beautiful palm tree, SubhanAllah. What a touch. And its walls were made of clay. But this was a modest masjid. It was with the tribes. And it was the first madrasa and the first university that took place in Masjid al-Nabawi. And it was also the headquarters of the Islamic State. It was a school where the Messenger of Allah instructed his companions, his Sahaba. In that modest building, he inspired the Muslims. He purified them in body and in spirit, and defined for them in truth, and made those Sahaba superhuman beings that they travel and spread Islam. And we say Alhamdulillah for that, because of that we are here today. So the role of a masjid is manifold. When we speak about the headquarters of the Islamic State supreme leadership, that's what it was. It was the center where the state's affairs were run. It was a meeting place where Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to meet the envoys and used to sign agreements and used to judge between disputing parties and so on. And after him, the Khulafa' al-Rashidun, they would outline his policies and addresses and debate with his subjects directly without any fear. This was all taking place in the masjid, my dear brothers. It was also at the time an important center for Islamic information, where the political, the social, the cultural, and the visual life was expressed. And it was a means of making da'wah. And whenever they wanted to give news, the adhan was given. The adhan was not only for salah, the adhan was also given if an important notice our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had to address the community. He would give the adhan and the people would gather. It was also a place of a judiciary court, as mentioned in Bukhari, under the heading asking a debtor to repay what he owes and catching the debtor in the masjid. So Bruce, if you see anybody here in the mosque, pray for me. The fire of the role of the mosque. The masjid is also a center of learning and a center of teaching. And such meetings, Allah's mercy surrounds them. The malaikats come and they pour their compassion because Allah has sent them. Khalaqatul Dhikr, for example. Look what Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. من جاء مسجدي هذا لم يأتي إلا لخير يتعلموه فهو بمنزلة المجاهد في سبيل الله. سبحان الله. Whoever comes to my mosque, says Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for no reason except to teach good or to learn it from himself or for himself or herself, then his likeness is of the one who strives في سبيل الله. In the path of Allah, may Allah make us of those, ya Rabbi. The masjid was also a platform where oratory and eloquence and was given, spoken, recited. Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha said, a girl who lived in a small room in the masjid used to come and talk to me, and every time she said, she recited the verses of poetry. In another report of Sayyidatina Aisha radiallahu anha, said that the Messenger of Allah would set aside a minbar, a pulpit, in the mosque for Hassan bin Thabit, and he would stand on it and he would recite his poetry and satirize whoever spoke against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And how much poetry haven't we heard from Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's companion Hassan bin Thabit, subhanallah. And he quotes, I quote to you, the Prophet said alayhi salam, inna ruha al-qudus ma'a Hassan ma nafa'a anil Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Messenger said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, verily the Holy Spirit is with Hassan as long as he defends the Messenger of Allah. It was also a detention center. And their free, the prisoners, their freedom was granted when they taught the Sahaba to write. If they were knowledgeable prisoners, their freedom was exchanged. You teach so many Sahabi, 5, 10, 15, and after a period of time, that is your freedom. It was a place where the all booties were divided. And this is mentioned in Bukhari Sharif, where the money came from Bahrain. Today we know it as Bahrain. It would come into Masjid al-Nabawi and the booties were dished out. It was a hospital where casualties of war were treated, reported by Imam Bukhari on the authority of Aisha radiallahu anha. He says Sa'ad ibn Mu'adh was injured in the battle of Khandaq. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pitched a tent in the masjid so that you could be near him and visit him. But because his wound was so serious, he eventually passed away, expired in the Masjid al-Nabawi, subhanAllah. This masjid, my dear brothers and sisters, is a home and a refuge for the poor and the needy, as well as the musafir, the travelers. Imam Bukhari reported that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam reserved a corner of the masjid as a shelter for the poor. And as you know, they were the Ahlul Suffa. Remember at the back of the Qabr of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there's a raised platform. I think nowadays you probably don't see it anymore because it's either gone or they've covered. I haven't been there for many, many years, probably 1999. So now, I don't know what it looks like. Is that platform still there? Subhanallah. Somebody says yes. The poor people, and they were so highly motivated. That's why you will find people of different tariqas. Because of the spirituality, you will find them sitting there. All the great Sufi sheikhs of the world, they will come there and sit there. Because they are called the fuqara. Not fuqara only in financial terms. They call themselves fuqara because in spiritual terms, they need Allah. Subhanallah. It is a place of relaxation. It's a place where siesta takes place. And masala, when I walk into this masjid town, time and again, I see people of different cultures and denominations come from Africa and they are resting. Alhamdulillah. This is what the purpose of a mosque is, my dear brothers. I'm not saying the whole Joe Slovo must come in here now, my dear brothers. That's a different story. So you can come here, yeah, Imam said, siesta, you know. Kanalapo. I have to watch my words. The place, the masjid is a place where the pleasure of Allah is sought. And as narrated by Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Imam Ahmad, that Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he who frequently goes to the masjid, Allah would prepare a place for him in heaven each time he came and went. Ya Allah, may Allah make us of those. Each time you've come and went, Allah is increasing your plot, your property. What an investment. You come, you go, you come, you go. It goes bigger and bigger. Whatever dimension, Ya Allah, Allah give us the best place. Also, seven categories of people will be in the shade of Allah on the day where there will be no shade. And one of them is a man or a woman whose heart is attached to the masjid. And again the Prophet says, he who purified himself, in other words, you made ghusl, you made wudu at home, and then walked to one of Allah's houses to perform one of Allah's commands, each one of his steps would wipe out a sin and the other would increase his rewards. Subhanallah, subhanallah. Ya Allah, what a kind Allah we have. Subhanallah. The masjid was also a place for the hungry and the needy, my dear brothers and sisters. Ya Allah, there's so many hadith, I have to go past them. There was also, it was also a place of celebration, socializing and amusement. As mentioned again by Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is, as mentioned by Sayyidatina Aisha, She said, the Messenger of Allah was once covering me. In other words, she was standing behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and her head was on the shoulder behind me. And I was watching the Abyssinians playing with the spears in the masjid. It's a type of game they were playing. Those who know the one about the legend in India, they played with sticks, you know what I'm talking about. The masjid is also a place where people in need can ask for help. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has permitted the needy person to seek help in the masjid. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, he came to the masjid alayhi salatu wasalam, and he said, has any one of you fed a needy person today? And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he says, I entered the masjid and I saw the man begging there. Abdul Rahman radiallahu anhu had a loaf of bread. I took it from his hand and I gave it to the needy person. This is what a masjid is all about, my dear brothers. It's a place for consultation, for exchanging ideas. I'm happy to say we had non-Muslims coming here. Remember the church group from Kilani? They've been coming here a couple of years now. They exchange ideas, no problem. We give it to them, whether they take it for themselves, but our ideas, we give it. Our dua talks, mashallah. How many times don't people come up and exchange and they differ? No problem, we love that. That is what it's all about, my dear brothers. As long as we are still Muslim brothers. That is important. Today, it's sad and it's a shame that some masjids are under-resourced. They are underfunded, underfunded. They're looking for money. They're incompetent management that takes place. And very male-orientated. Ya subhanallah. This is not the role of a masjid. Remember when Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, he says, لا تمنعوا إماء الله أن يصلين في المسجد. Ibn Umar reported the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, do not prevent the maidens of Allah from praying in the mosques. فقال ابن له إنا لمنعوهن. Then a man came up and he said, indeed, I will prevent them. I'm sure this sounds very familiar if you come from the Joburg area, my dear brothers. Look at the hadith. فغضب غضبا شديدا. Ibn Umar رضي الله عنه, he became very angry and he said, وقال أحدثك عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم تقول إنا لنمنعهن. I narrate to you from Nabi Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and you still say you want to prevent them. سبحان الله. يا الله. We have seen some of the masajids, some of the mutawallis, astaghfirullah, they even steal. Some of the imams think that this mihrab belongs to them. Allah protect me, ya Allah. This is the domain of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is all. That is it. Not yours, not mine. Nobody's. It belongs to Allah. End of story, my dear brothers. We have seen this unity in leadership taking place, especially in this part of the world. I take you right back to 1794. 1794 was the first masjid that was built in Cape Town, in South Africa for that matter. It was the Oval Masjid in Door Street. Qadi Abdul Salam Tuanguru, as we know him, a very pious, clever man that was brought from overseas, he became the first imam here. Just to give you a bit of a history, many of us, I need to make a khutbah of this. You see, many of the pious people that are sleeping all around the Cape, Sheikh Nurman Matibi Shah, Sheikh Nurul Mubin, Sheikh Yusuf, and I can go on and on. You think these were idiots? Astaghfirullah, ma'adallah. I'll give you one example of this person. When he came to the Cape, he was banished to Robben Island, for he was captured and by the Dutch, because he connived with the British to overthrow the Dutch. At that time the Dutch were strong. So they banished him to Robben Island. When he was eventually freed after 15 or 18 years, he came to Tanabaru, as we know, and they made him the first imam. He wrote a kitab from memory, Usul al-Fiqh, in the Shafi'i Madhab. And he wrote from memory the entire Quran, many copies. Up till today, if you go to Awwal Mosque, you will see that one of the original copies still there. These are the people we are talking about, my dear brothers. Just a little bit of a history on one side. But I need to say, sadly, although he was the first Imam, there was fighting. Ya Allah. There was fighting. Again, because he didn't like the Imam, personality clashes. So you see our history in Cape, when it comes to personality clashes, as far as Imams is concerned, it's nothing new. It started already in our history. And it looks like it's perpetuating, my dear brother. Allah protect us. May Allah protect this masjid and this mihrab, Ya Allah. And just a little bit of example. The reason why the palm tree, that's the irony of it, the palm tree related to Medina, but the palm tree was in Long Street, you know, not the one on the bottom, the further up where the house is. That came as a result because I don't like that Imam, so let me build another mosque. So as a result, I don't like the Imam, that masjid came about. This is a disunity that took place. I mean, and I can go on and on, my dear brother. How many mosques are there in Cape Town? Kapili Street, one on top, one in the bottom. Do you know the history why there's two? You know the history why there's two in Salt River, in Tennyson Road? And you must know the Malay community, I'm talking about the Malay that came from that time. Eventually they were strong. So they decided that no Indians must come to the Tennyson Road. They can't partake on the committee. So what did the Indians do? They went to Addison Road and created that. This is our history, my dear brothers. You and I have to know this. I was personally involved in Weinberg in the 60s when the big sheikh, may Allah grant him all the best, inshallah, and forgive him for his, was involved when he split the communities. It happened. Community was split because of I am the sheikh. And we can carry on, and we can carry on, and we can carry on. It is ugly, my dear brother. For a masjid, I remember my sheikh that took over, Sayyid Abdul Qadir, rahimullah, from Fori Kramat. One question was asked. We need to make two dhuhr in one mihrab, one here and one there, two parties, two asr, two maghrib, two ishar. This was the reality, and this I have seen. And may Allah make it that's the last, my dear brothers, Ya Allah. That's why disunity in the world is because we all say we love the Prophet, we love Allah and so forth. But no, I think we love us more than everybody else. We are nothing, my neighbors. We are nothing. Allah protect us, Ya Allah. The masjid is not a public or a private corporation, my dear brothers and sisters. It is not an association, it's not a charity organization, nothing like that. It is not a land, a piece of land where the rituals are monopolized. No. For the whole world, the whole dunya is a masjid. And that's what it is, my dear brothers. We have seen in America, simple aspect to show you, because Sheikh Al-Asi has been making for the last 30 years Jummah outside. It's because the Americans got rid of him from the mosque because he's speaking against the Saudis. You understand the politics that's going on, my dear brothers? It's too much of that. And the purpose to build a masjid is for one purpose, as Allah said, وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. And the masjid are for Allah alone. So do not invoke anyone else besides Allah. Subhanallah. This masjid, subhanallah, I can categorically say it has been built on the basis of taqwa. Go read the history on the websites and so forth. But why I want to say this is because an ayat was revealed in the Quran in the time of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where a certain monk built a mosque, Masjid al-Dirar, opposite, in competition, subhanallah, next to Masjid al-Quba. Why? Personalities. And he was evil. He wasn't even a Muslim. Eventually, the ayah came, La taqum fihi abada. Don't you ever stand in that mosque. لمسجد أسس على التقوى من أول يوم أحق أن تقوم فيه. Verily, the masjid whose foundation was laid from the first day on piety is more worthy than you to stand therein. فيه رجال يحبون أن يتطهروا. In it are people, men and women, who love to clean themselves and to purify themselves. And Allah loves those who makes themselves clean and pure. Subhanallah. Brothers and sisters, Ya Allah. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about Masjid Quba. He says, Salatun fi Masjid Quba ka Umrah. The person who makes salah in Masjid Quba, it is as if you have performed an Umrah. Allahu Akbar. So go. Those who are able to go. Go for Umrah and go to Masjid Quba for Umrah. Subhanallah. Ya Allah. Ya Allah. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said, Man bana masjidan lillahi banallahu lahu fil jannah misluhu. The one who builds a mosque for Allah, then Allah will build for him something like it in paradise. May Allah make us part of it, Ya Rab. Ya Rab. You know, time goes so quickly. I have so much to talk and say. It reminds me of Harun al-Rashid, the great Khalifa of the Muslim Empire in the Abbasid time. His wife's name, I don't want to speak about him. I want to speak about his wife. His wife's name was Zubaydah. She was an unbelievable, pious woman. And a heart of gold. Subhanallah. She was, if you were to read her history, read it, my dear brothers. I think all the Zubaydahs that I know are like that. May Allah bless them and protect them. Good heart. Straight talk. But what a heart. Zubaydah was the one. May Allah bless her. Rahimallah. She was so pious that she hired many huffaz in her palace to recite the Quran 24 hours in shifts. And she had to pay them. So she heard the Quran 24 hours, of course, when she was sleeping, but at different vantage points in the entire palace, the Quran was being heard. We had a sound system, speaker system. She used the real McCoy, she used huffaz. This was Zubaydah. Zubaydah was the one, if you can remember or might not remember, on Arafah, if you go to Jabal Rahma, you see some ruins there. She made sure she built a well so that the Hujjaz can have water. And the story goes on and on. I'm not going to give you the whole history of Zubaydah, my dear brother. She even built a road, not like these roads, from Baghdad to Mecca for the Hujjaz. This was the way that my dear brother, subhanallah, ya Allah. Hey, you know, so husband and wife, Harun al-Rashid and Zubaydah, they were walking past the river and they met Bahlul. Bahlul was called the wise fool, but he was a wali of Allah, but also he acted stupid and crazy and dumb. Why? Sometimes it's nice to act like that and people will run away from people like that. You know, Majnun people run away. Because there is lust. Somebody phoned me up, pastor. Imam, mayat, janaza. I said, yeah, my mother's dood. What can I know? I pass two for batok na 7 o'clock. Yeah, Imam. And I haven't got the heart to bawl the lady out as well, you know. But okay. So, yeah, the two walk. And Bahlul tells them, he's busy making castles, you see. And Bahlul says, if you buy one of these castles for a dinar, I will make dua to Allah to give you a palace in Jannah. So Harun al-Rashid laughed him off, you see. But Zubaydah gave the dinar. That night Harun al-Rashid is sleeping and he dreams. He's coming to the entrance of a beautiful palace and on it is written Zubaydah. And as he walks in, there are the Asgaris, the guards, the Malaikat, Sorry, this is reserved for Zubayda. Dit is niet voor jou, niet. Weg het de jongen. Je hebt jouw kans gehad en je hebt het niet gevat, nee. So when he wakes up the evening again, he goes down to the riverside and he tells Bahlul, Dinar, please make dua, Allah gives. He says, no, the price has gone up. The kingdom, your kingdom I want. Now he was the Khalifa of the Ummah. How can the Khalifa also give a kingdom? He couldn't, subhanAllah, my dear brothers and sisters, subhanAllah. So, my dear brothers and sisters, it reminds us, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهُ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. They are those who believe in the unseen. وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ, and they stand for the salah. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ, and they spend of themselves and they give, my dear brothers. This was Zubaydah. And I think the Zubaydahs that I know, they're all like that. You know, like you say, the Yusuf, the Khribalak, you know? Like my one son, Yusuf, you know, the Khribalak in a nice way. I think that Allah has made all the Zubaydahs like that as well. May Allah bless and protect them, Ya Rabbi. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us conscious what the true role of a masjid is, inshallah, that we can be part of it, and that whatever small part, my dear brothers and sisters, and this masjid, if you take the ticklers and the points that I have been given you, my dear brothers and sisters, there are many points you can take, subhanAllah, and that is all because of your kindness, and all because of your dua. It is because of your financial support, and it's because of your emotional support that this masjid, with the blessings, bi'idhnillah, is what it is today, subhanAllah. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.